And I'm going to share with you 5 embarrassing things that patients do after surgery but don't remember doing. It has to do with how anesthesia affects your brain and how it comes out of your brain and why you don't remember some of these things. Fortunately, your doctors and nurses and everyone else will be compassionate and won't make fun of you, but you should still know what you're prone to doing and how you might be able to prevent it. So this is a real life operating room that I'm in. And things that I've seen in here include, number one, the most common thing that you've probably all heard before. And that's waking up from anesthesia, confessing your utter love for the surgical staff, the anesthesiologist, the surgeon, nurses, whoever it might be. Sometimes there might be kind of a team switch that can happen from a combination of the disinhibiting effects of anesthesia, whether it's the gases that come out of the ventilator, like the sevoflurane here, whether it's from the white medication named propofol. These all tend to have effects not too different at certain doses to alcohol that can cause people to say or do things that they ordinarily would not do, including switching teams and confessing their love. Asking me out for dinner, for coffee, eloping have all happened, but patients don't remember it because of the timing after surgery. We'll talk about that in a moment. The next one is fighting your doctor when you wake up. Not only fist fighting, that's a different one we'll get to, but fighting insisting that the surgery never happened. Why does this happen? So this has to do partly with the mental health state of patients before they go under anesthesia. There are some surgeries, after all, that don't have large scars. So for example, if you had open heart surgery, well, you would have a giant scar down your sternum with staples that you can tell on an x-ray that there was heart surgery there. You would know. You have lots of lines of evidence. However, other procedures, colonoscopies, endoscopies, pain injections, arthroscopies, meaning when they put a small camera inside part of your body in a joint, or laparoscopy, putting a small camera inside your abdomen, for example. These are minimally invasive surgeries that happen in operating rooms like this one here, and they don't always leave scars to prove to the patient that they had surgery. So often they might wake up if they were already gaslit by surgeons before or by other doctors, maybe manipulated, maybe they felt coerced. Patty, thank you for the kind super thanks there. That's very kind of you, I appreciate it. That element of distrust though, like I was saying, when patients fall asleep with that distrust, they appear to be more likely to be distrusting of the result after surgery. It's not surprising, especially when you add medications into the mix that already will disinhibit the frontal cortex and prefrontal cortex from doing what it typically does. And Leon Rose, good to see you on your first live. Tammy is saying that they were angry after surgery. We'll get there in a moment. But waking up and fighting, I've seen it happen so many times, insisting that the surgery did not happen. We can show photos because we have to document what happened, but there's still this confabulation. Those photos are from a different patient, doctor. You didn't do the surgery. So we typically need to wait for that anesthesia to fully wear off. They still may not remember their initial response. However, like I said, the best is to prevent this from happening by acknowledging that so many patients have already encountered betrayal of trust from doctors or other healthcare professionals. And this is setting the stage for this to happen after surgery. It is so important that we include patients in the decision making for big events like surgery in particular. Next, number 3, the kicking and screaming angry patient that can happen after anesthesia. And this does happen, often happens in younger adults. Teenage boys are the common stereotype, though it can happen in anyone. We also see it in very older and elderly individuals who are really knee-deep in emergence delirium, which sometimes can last even days after surgery. This is a result of many factors, including one's pre-surgery mental health state, like their anxiety, depression, history of PTSD, as well as maybe loneliness compounded on top of that, certainly will or can exacerbate so many of these psychological conditions that we need to recognize can contribute to patients hurting themselves or others after surgery. They may not remember it, I'll explain why at the end, but they might actively be cussing, and physically hurting others or even themselves. The common one is scratching their face, giving themselves corneal abrasions, pulling out breathing tubes. We see this in the intensive care unit when patients are delirious and in the operating room. It also has to do with the amount of anesthesia that was given, the type of anesthesia that was given, the type of surgery, unmanaged pain, abnormal oxygen and carbon dioxide levels in the body, and perhaps most importantly, substance use. So we absolutely know that cannabis, methamphetamines, cocaine, any of the above can certainly influence the anesthesia interacting with your brain to lead to that emergence delirium that you're not going to remember when you wake up. Then number four is patients that wake up not wanting to leave the operating room at all. You would think that if you were in this kind of scary room and you were done, you would be bolting out of the room because a lot of patients are afraid to come in the first place. But when we don't want to leave the operating room, what is going on? This is like a patient that wakes up saying, "Doc, I just want to stay here. I don't want to go back. That was the best sleep of my life. Can I go back to sleep?" This happens, of course, for many reasons. And I see people already saying, Maribel Lily Flowers, saying that's me. So this can happen for many reasons. Number one, well, you are in a relaxed, hopefully trusted environment, knowing that people are caring for you with utmost compassion. Hopefully, that is how you fell asleep. When you fall asleep that way, you're more likely to wake up that way. And gosh, I gotta say, sadly, most of my patients have not experienced that level of, call it TLC or tender loving care, or have been in such a trusting, relaxing environment. Yes, there's surgery going on, but you also have people, you know what I tell my patients before they fall asleep? You are the most important person to us in the whole world for the next 1, 2, 3, 5 hours. So if I have a patient, for example, who has been lonely, and I know many of you commiserate with that, that might be the first time they have heard that in weeks, months, or years, maybe decades. Well, you add that with the effects of anesthesia on the brain, which there is some pleasurable effects, certainly, and patients might not, their gut reaction when they wake up might be to not want to leave. Now, we also see this in individuals that have young kids at home, and it's truly the first break they've gone in a while. So keeping all that in mind, some of the mental health reasons behind why there is so much sometimes desire to not want to go home, but there's other reasons as well. I'm not just limiting it down to that, but that's something very important to recognize when I see patients waking up that way. Now, this is a quick shout out. You know, I had a long day in the operating room. If you appreciate me coming on for this live, do please hit that like button and share what you learned with others to empower others to take control over their health. You know, you have a lot of power over your health that often doctors or big pharma or the medical community doesn't always share with patients. Not necessarily for nefarious reasons, but because it's just a lot of information. I hope that you are learning something. And if you have, just share with a loved one. Please do that. If you could hit the like button and subscribe to keep up with lives, I'd appreciate that too. It really does mean a lot, so I can do this more often. But this is for you, first and foremost. I don't like to do product placement, as you know. This is knowledge for you to empower yourself. So let's get to the last one. And this is maybe the juiciest one, also the most inappropriate one. When patients wake up from anesthesia, the number of inappropriate jokes that come up. Yes, some of them are hurtful based on the color of one's skin. Some of them are hurtful based on any number of other identities, etc. I won't go into the specifics, but this is also something that's really telling when patients wake up and start saying horribly inappropriate things. Hey, Roberts, thank you for that kind comment, by the way. Roberta Lucao, thank you for that. Yes, someone said flirty. Yes, they are flirty, skater, surfer, snowboarder. Good to see you. That was number one, actually, the flirty wake-ups. But when patients wake up putting others down, this is a hallmark of narcissistic behaviors, either of grandiosity or of vulnerability, both of which can come up in the operating room. I have an upcoming video on that, so we'll talk all about that and how both types reveal under anesthesia, and specifically these comments that people will make, which they may never remember, can certainly fall or can certainly be a result of those behaviors and how they view others. So I've seen people from all different parts of the world wake up saying all sorts of really inappropriate things, often putting down a particular race or a particular group of people. Is it funny in the moment? I mean, yeah, we laugh about it, but is it also come from something deeper down that the anesthesia has exposed by literally peeling back layers of your frontal cortex? Something worth considering. I'm not saying these people need to be reprimanded in the operating room. That's not reasonable because of all the things going on, the fears, the vulnerabilities, doubts, uncertainties, pain, effects of anesthesia, etc. But you gotta wonder, what pain and suffering are they dealing with deep down that is now being apparent because of the vulnerabilities and the effects of anesthesia that are forcing it out? Now, of course, these could be coping mechanisms. These are stressed out individuals, and maybe you think it's appropriate to make a joke, however offensive or inappropriate. I mean, sometimes they're funny, but not in the appropriate way. I'm not condoning that. I'm not a comedian here, right? I'm not saying that we should, the operating room is not a place to be making those jokes, but they are perhaps coping mechanisms to diffuse, project, etc. Heidi, thank you for that kind super thanks. So many great questions we'll have to get to in other lives, but I need to end by telling you why we don't remember saying or doing these things. And someone's asking about ketamine and the cost. Well, you should watch my other videos about ketamine. I do have a ketamine infusion clinic. There is a responsible and ethical way of using ketamine to transform lives with very few treatments. Depends on your mental health, of course, and your physical health, but that's a topic for a different videos that I've done. I want to tell you about why you don't remember, right? So let's put ketamine aside, very, very powerful drug, but why don't you remember the effect, what you do after you wake up? So you don't remember these things because how anesthesia comes out of your brain, whether it's from gas or whether it's IV, is because your brain has like 15,000 things it does. Anesthesia knocks them out kind of piece by piece. The most resistant things to anesthesia, meaning the ones that it takes the most anesthesia to knock out, are your breathing and your reflexes for survival. Cardiovascular reflexes, airway protective reflexes, meaning your cough reflex, gag reflex, etc. So it takes a lot of anesthesia to knock those out. However, it only takes a little bit of anesthesia to knock out your memory formation. So as you're falling asleep, the first thing to go is your memory formation. And then as you get sleepier and sleepier and deeper, you may stop breathing, etc., so that your body can undergo the surgery stress. Now, when you're waking up, it's kind of like the opposite direction. The first thing to come back online is your spinal reflexes, your cardiovascular reflexes, your airway protective reflexes. That's why people begin to groan and try to pull the tube out. They try to cross their body with their arms because that's the first thing to come back online as you wake up. The last thing to come back online are the most sensitive parts of your brain, the memory formation centers. So the memory formation centers take longest to come back online, so you can be moving, responding to pain, for all intents and purposes, almost be speaking like a normal human being, but you're not gonna remember because the anesthesia has to completely exit your brain. Your brain has to come fully back online for the most sensitive parts of your cortex to become active again. That takes the most time. So you can be walking, talking, peeing, pooing, doing everything else, the bodily functions, your memory takes the longest, typically. So that's why you can be doing the love confessions, the eloping, asking me out for coffee, kicking, denying the surgery happened, cussing, screaming, making the inappropriate jokes. Everything we went through, you can do because those don't necessarily require active memory formation. That typically takes 30 to 60 minutes to come back online, though it depends on the type of anesthesia, the type of surgery, your sensitivity to anesthesia, your medical history, the medications that you take, any substances that you use. So it depends on many factors. But for the average day surgery, which is what some of the most common surgeries are in the world, those are typically 30 to 60 minutes. Using Versed or midazolam or those powerful benzodiazepines can make that a little bit longer. But typically, it's on that order of time. And like Crystal Spirit says, midazolam does make you forget even though you're fully active and interacting with others. So I hope that you all learned something new, not only about what you do and forget, but also how you can prevent yourself from getting there. It involves compassion, both you projecting to others in the form of gratitude and compassion that you receive from your doctors and trusted ones. So like Enrique Sanchez said, absolutely, I wish that every patient coming into an operating room like this, going under anesthesia, is told by the doctor that they're trusting their life to, that they are the most important person in the world for the next hour, two or three. That level of trust can help patients wake up doing fewer embarrassing things and also, more importantly, fewer dangerous things to themselves and those around them, setting themselves up for a smoother recovery. And some of these spontaneous healing stories that we hear after psychedelic experiences, after ketamine, after surgery and anesthesia, are more likely to happen when you fall asleep with that positive mindset in the first place. Thank you everyone for your support. Once again, you hitting that like button helps me do this for you more often. Till next time, remember that you have more power over your health than you've probably ever been told.